Good evening, everybody, and welcome to this another episode of Ortho TV original webinar series. And today we have with us Dr. Atul Bhaskar. He's a senior pediatric orthopedic surgeon in Mumbai, working as assistant honorary at R.N. Cooper Hospital and Apollo Hospital now in Mumbai. He has his own clinic, Children's Orthopedic Clinic in Mumbai. He'll be speaking to us today on how to avoid complications in forearm fractures. So over to you, Atul sir, for the talk.
Okay, thank you, Ashok, and greetings from Apollo Hospital and the Children Orthopedic Clinic in Mumbai. I must acknowledge Dr. Ashok Shyam and Dr. Neeraj Bijlani and Ortho TV for bringing out these educational activities on children fractures. So my topic is going to be on how to avoid complications in forearm fractures or the nuances in pediatric forearm fracture management. Now, unlike the lower limb, in the upper limb, children tend to get more injuries because of when they have to break the fall. And that's why we see more fractures in the upper limb. And because these fractures can be highly variable depending on the level of the fracture, depending on the completeness, and depending on the deformity, one has to understand and one has to recognize what type of fracture this is. So I would not go much in the classification, but I would go and highlight all these problems and all the classification by way of examples. So coming with the first case, this is a child, 7-year-old boy who had an undisplaced fracture of the forearm. And you can see he's got fractures of both the bones, which is not badly displaced. He was put in a cast and there was this volar angulation, which was accepted at the time. And then when the child presented in the clinic, the angulation got worse, almost about 30 degrees. And the parents were upset because the child could not fully supinate the forearm. And then they wanted to know what went wrong and how would you counsel this child. Second case is the child who came with a very good looking x-ray. You can see the bones are well aligned. But you see the arm, he's got an arm in hypersupination. And this child, when the cast came off, was stuck like this and he lacked complete pronation. So it is not easy, it is not acceptable to just treat the x-ray. One has to see the limb of the child as well. Another child, this was the x-ray at presentation. At 3 weeks, this is the displacement of a Soltari type 2 injury. This child then came with a CT scan and he wanted a re-manipulation of the fracture. And so how do you counsel this? Would you advise doing this? Or would you leave it alone? Another example is, whenever you see a forearm fracture, don't think of the bone. One has to look at the joints above and below. So this child presented like this. The treating surgeon thought it's only a fracture of the ulna, and you can see from his notes, he just put the child in a plaster, and then at follow-up, he removed the plaster, but still did not recognize that there is a problem in the proximal radial ulna joint. And this is not uncommon in practice. When you see a forearm fracture, we often ignore the proximal as well as the distal joint. And this is unpardonable that you leave a joint which is dislocated. Similarly, another child from a teaching hospital presented with this injury. And you can see from the discharge card, this child was treated in a plaster. It was documented green stick fracture of the proximal third of the ulna. And when the child came back at 6 weeks, one could see a bump in the front, the restriction of elbow flexion, and this child again had a proximal radiocapital dislocation. So any forearm fracture which come in practice, it's always better to have x-rays of both the joints, but at the same time one must recognize subluxation and dislocation of the joint above and below. And whenever I get a child with a deformity, I always measure the angulation. It is no point just eyeballing it, because when you measure the angulation only, you can counsel them. So before you counsel them, you measure the angulation, and this angulation measures about 28 degrees. If you just eyeball it, you may say 15 degrees, 20 degrees, and then as you follow up these children, you don't know how to counsel the parents at what rate the deformity corrects. Now what is known that if you leave 10 degrees of deformity in volar or dorsal direction, you won't find much loss of motion. But when the angulation more than 10 degrees, either it is dorsal angulation, volar angulation, or towards the interosseous membrane, then the loss of range of motion is very high. So typically, if you have 10 degree, more than 10 degree pronation or supination deformity, more than 10 degree angulation, we get a 20 degree deformity in rotation. So it is the rotation loss is almost double the amount of angulation. And one should be aware of this. So if you have a 20 degree angulation, the loss of rotation will be 40 degrees. So this is a rough rule of thumb. Whenever you counsel the parents that if that is the amount of deformity the child has got, that is the loss of range, and rotational deformities will take almost 1.5 to 2 years to remodel, whereas the angular deformities remodel faster. And I'll come to that. So we know that the rate of remodeling in forearm fractures is about 5 to 7 degrees per year. It may be higher for the lower fractures, and it depends on the age of the child, the size of the fracture, and the plane of the deformity. The younger the child, distal the fracture, depending on the apex of the deformity, the rate of remodeling is much higher. So you can roughly tell the parents that they will correct at about 2 to 3 degrees per month for a lower third fractures, and for the middle third fractures, about 3 to 4 degrees per month. So this is just a rough rule, and this is for more for the older children. So one can counsel the parents that this child will remodel, and we should just let the function improve. Now one should also have some knowledge of biomechanics. Whenever there's a pronation of the forearm, the radius will shorten. So if there's a pronation deformity, there's forearm shortening. I mentioned this, if there's poor reduction of 10 degrees, the rotated loss is 20 degrees. It's almost double. Bayonet apposition is acceptable, and we'll come with some examples. And remember one thing, in a child, the periosteum is intact on the concave side, and that gives us a fulcrum or gives us a kind of support or a buttress to work on. So remember that you always bend towards the side of the convexity, because the concave side tissues are intact. Also, don't forget the bioanatomy. You must understand that the interosseous membrane is just not a simple membrane. This is what prevents the bones from dislocating or for disrupting. So this also holds the joint proximally as well as distally with the help of the TFCC. There's a contribution from the interosseous ligament. So it's very important to remember this. When we see the X-ray, we only look at the bones, but one should appreciate if there's significant deformity or displacement, then there's disruption of the membrane. Also, one must have some idea about the appearance of the epiphyses and what age they fuse, typically for the lower radius and the ulna. So when you're treating these fractures, one can counsel the parents that if the growth plate is open, that child has got good remodeling potential. So coming with some examples, this is a deformity which is called plastic deformation, which is only seen in children. It's a very, very common entity in children, and sometimes you will find it will just present as a deformity. There will be no break on the X-ray. And if you see this child, you can see on the right side, the child is unable to supinate the hand. And you can see that on the X-ray, that there is a complete deformity. There's a pronation deformity on the right side, by you can see the crossover sign. So this child had no pain at the very minimal pain, but significant deformity in the forearm. So most of the plastic deformation will present with restriction of motion, and you will not see much callus formation because it's mainly periosteal healing, and remodeling in these deformities is poor because there is no break of the bone. And there was a paper published in the JPO that plastic deformation occurs because of the way the unique structure of the child's bone. They have got no collagen, and hence the bones are more plastic. But it can lead to significant deformity which may persist. And that has been shown by this paper. And one of the other features is you will not see any fracture lines. And there's no callus formation except rotational deformity. So one has to be aware. One must know that when the hand is in supination, the tuberosity is facing medially. When the hand is mid-prone, the tuberosity is in the front. And if it's in prone, the tuberosity goes lateral. And that's how you judge the rotation of the child. And you can see on this side, the classical plastic deformation, the elbow X-ray looks AP, but the X-ray becomes lateral here. So there is a 90 degree rotation deformity. Now, to treat these deformities, if it's less than 5 years, one can leave it alone. But if its child is between 6 to 20 years, and there is more than 20 degree deformity, then one has to correct it. In a child more than 10 years, any deformity more than 15 degrees must be corrected. In conditions when one bone is deformed and one joint is subluxated, you must restore the alignment, because you can have joint subluxation with plastic deformation, and I'll give you an example of that. And there are various techniques to correct the deformity. You can use the fulcrum technique or the interosseous mold technique. This is what I find very easy to use. Sometimes this can cause a lot of swelling of the soft tissues and compartment syndrome. So I find this technique is easier, and you give a well molded cast. And like I said earlier, the results are not very good. This was a follow-up of almost 18 months, 11 children. And you can see that there was unacceptable deformity in almost 9 children. So almost 75% of children had unacceptable deformity, because plastic deformation takes a lot of force to correct. So example of a child, this is a child who got a right side deformity, and you can see the clinical malalignment. You can see the mid forearm is rotated 90 degrees, and this is the X-rays, and you can see on the lateral view, this is a lateral view of the elbow, but AP view of the distal end. So there's a 90 degree rotation, and you can correct this under the C-arm, and you can restore the alignment very well. So simply you have to break the deformity. You have to use force, but don't use excessive force, and then give a well padded cast. And this child came back at 4 weeks. You can see that the callus is forming here because we had to break this bone, and then he gets full range of movement. Now this is what I mentioned: when there is deformation of one bone and the joint is subluxed on the radiocapital joint is subluxed, this deformation you have to correct it, otherwise the joint will not reduce. And you can see the lateral Montager fracture. This is a type 3 where the radial head is subluxed laterally, and they also have got posterior interosseous nerve involvement, especially when they have these type 3 injuries. Now this child, we tried to manipulate, it was almost impossible to break the ulna. So we did osteoclases, drill osteoclases, and then to maintain the correction, we passed this rigid stainless steel wire so that the deformity doesn't come back. Remember, these deformities have got a memory and they can recur. So it's best to stabilize them with a medullary rod. And then this child healed very well, and then we removed the rod, and this was his final function. So plastic deformation of one bone causing deformity of the other bone must be corrected, especially when there is joint subluxation. Now coming to the next set of fractures, which is called the Greenstick fractures. Again, one has to be very, very careful in how we interpret the site of deformity and the angulation. Otherwise, these fractures can come back and, you know, hit us with a stick. So very, very important again to analyze before we treat. So always analyze the fracture and then you plan the treatment. Now if you see these two fractures, you can see that the apex in this forearm is on the dorsal side, and here it's on the volar side. Both the injuries are green stick, but there is a major difference in the direction of the angulation, and this is important to understand, because there is what is called the rotation angulation correlation. So whenever there is a volar apex deformity, that means there is a supination injury, and when there's a pronation injury, you have what is called an apex dorsal fracture. So whenever there's pronation injury, is apex dorsal, and again, like I mentioned earlier, the radius is shortened. For any pronation injury, the radius appears a bit shortened. You can see the direction of the injury, and this has been described by Dr. Evans in as far as 1951, that superficial injuries have got a volar apex, and the pronation injuries have a dorsal apex. So once we understand the pattern of the injury, is very easy to manage, because we can simply reverse the rotation and it will correct the angulation. For example, this child who had a pronation deformity, we put the cast in supination, and you can see the bones are very, very well aligned, and this is a very well padded cast. And again, this cast is a key feature in children, because that's the only one which holds the bone. There is no internal fixation. Similarly, this child who had a distal fracture, a volar apex supination injury, we immobilize in pronation, and you can see that the bone is well maintained, and you can see the crossover sign here that the forearm is in pronation. This is very, very critical, how you keep the child in the cast and how you maintain it, because this will maintain the alignment. If this is not followed, chances are that the fracture will displace and the deformity will come back. The complete fractures are different because they are inherently unstable, so the principles will differ. Because there has got more disruption, there is angular instability, there is rotational instability, and there is much more soft tissue injury. So the complete fractures need further assessment and need more rigid treatment. And coming to some of these complete fractures, you can see here both the cortices are broken. And this child was only 11 years of age. And this was the plaster applied to the child, and you can see the alignment in the cast. And if you look at the mismatch of the medullary cavity, you can see there is a rotation malalignment in this X-ray. And also, if you look at the AP view, you can see the tuberosity is on the AP, but on the distal end, the it's a lateral view. So there is a rotation of the forearm, and you can see that this is a 90 degree rotation in the cast itself. Similarly, another child, this is an 8-year-old child, presents after 1 week, and you can see here. So this child had this child presented after 1 week, and I think the subsequent X-ray is missing. But this child again had a malalignment because his bone deformed. Now I'll come to that. So again, events concept and X-ray are very important. Events would describe the concept of rotation again, as given as finding on the X-ray. So tuberosity is 180 degrees to the radial solid. So you remember one thing: the tuberosity of the biceps is 180 degrees, and that is the true AP alignment. And on the lateral view, the coronal process of the ulna is 90 degrees to the sternoid. So once you have this in mind, you can analyze the X-rays based on the finding of the coronal process and the ulna sternoid. So if you look at the X-rays again, this child, you can see there's a mismatch of the medullary cavity, and if you look at the alignment which has been now restored, the tuberosity is here and the sternoid process is there. So we have remanipulated this fracture by supinating the distal fragment, and we restore the alignment. This kind of apposition is acceptable because there is no rotation. So don't worry about this kind of bayonet apposition, because this will always heal in a child of 11 years of age. Again, remember the crossover sign. So in a true AP view, you can see the tuberosity is here, and this is the standard process. This is the mid prone. You can see that the overlap is in the lower part, and in the true pronation, the overlap is in the upper part, upper third. So radius will overlap in the upper third, and this is a pronation X-ray. So in complete pronation, you can find that the tuberosity is lateral and the radius overlaps proximally. And this is very important to understand rotation alignment in the child. And this is what I always emphasize on. Always think of the four dimension. Very commonly, we always think of angulation, we think of displacement, we think of shortening, but we always forget rotation. And rotation is a clinical alignment as well as X-ray alignment. And you can see, for example, this child had a fracture of the left forearm, and with the deformity, whole apex deformity, significant, almost 20 to 30 degrees, and child could not supinate. And that is why it is very important to analyze these deformities at the beginning. Similarly, another child, you can see, had a complete malrotation of the hand, and he was unable to supinate his left hand, whereas on the right hand he can do it. So he's unable to supinate because of the complete 90 degree malrotation. So very often we find children coming with these kind of deformities for correction because the initial management has been suboptimal. Now coming to a complete displaced fracture, this is a child, 7-year-old boy with the fall from a swing. You can see the plaster was given with above elbow cast with 90 degree flexion, and you can see the cast application at 1 week. Of course, there are some fallacies here. You can see that the bone is sagging here. The cast index is not good. There's a lot of padding, and there's a slippage of the olecranon from the edge of the cast. And this is not uncommon when you have a lot of swelling, and as the swelling subsides, the ulna bone will subside and will slip, and the cast will slip proximally, and you will get this kind of malalignment. And this measured almost 20 degrees. So this cast is we know that if we continue with this alignment, this will get further displaced. This is another child. You can see the post-reduction X-rays again. This is a 6-year-old boy, and you can see the cast alignment again. There's a lot of padding. You can see the swelling has subsided, and the ulna bone sags 1 week later. So this is not uncommon. And this is where the cast application becomes very important, so that you don't get this kind of soft tissue. As the soft tissue swelling subsides, you don't get this kind of malalignment in the X-ray. And question is whether this is acceptable, and how do we manage this? So one must know what are the limits of acceptability. For a child less than 9 years, it is 15 degrees. For a child more than 9 years, it's 10 degrees. Rotation less than 45 degrees in a less than 9-year-old child. In more than 9 years, less than 30 degrees. shortening is acceptable, usually it's not a problem. And this is one must kind of have a mental picture of this chart whenever you treat forearm fractures. So we see the earlier child, 7-year-old boy, 20 degree angulation, so it's more than 15 degrees, not acceptable. So this child, we had to do a remanipulation, and we put this child in a long arm cast. And you can see the long arm cast again needs a special technical advice here. You have to mold the cast around the elbow, what is called supracondylar molding, and you must pad the thumb very well so that the cast doesn't slip. And you must pad the thin eminence so they don't get any pressure points there. So long arm cast and extension is very good for treating unstable fractures. You can give the cast for 4 weeks and then change back to a cast in flexion after 4 weeks so that the child is more comfortable. Again, the molding technique is very well described and there is no risk of elbow stiffness. And this has been well documented in a number of papers. So this is what I was coming to earlier. This is a 4-year-old child. You had a cast application done, you can see, and he gets a sag. And you can see what happened with this poor cast application. There was so much of padding. So this was acceptable in the cast here, and then the plaster slips. And that's where when the parents come to us, you know, with this X-ray, of course, this is a 4-year-old child, one can leave it alone. But then they're always upset. Why did it slip? And then one has to really counsel them about the subsidence of swelling and how the fracture can be displaced. So very important about casting technique, you must follow the principles. Good intraocular molding, appropriate padding, make sure you don't leave any pressure points, and you straighten the ulnar border. This is very critical. In fact, sometimes I make the border convex so that the bone doesn't sag, and have a good three point mold. So this is what a good cast application is. It must be an oval cast, so you can maintain a 3-point pressure. So this is an X-ray of a child at 1 week. You can see this how the bone is malunited at 4 weeks. So this child didn't come back for follow-up, and now he's got a malunion. Another child, you can see at 3 weeks, he presented at 3 weeks with a fracture like this, malunating fracture in the cast. Again, the fracture slips, child didn't follow up, came directly at 3 weeks, and you can see the bone sags. So as a principle, when I treat forearm fractures, I always call the child back every week in the clinic, and we do a weekly X-ray for the first 3 weeks. Because whatever is going to happen in the first 3 weeks, and when they come like this at 3 weeks, already the deformity is significant. And I think the measurements are gone, but this child had almost a 40 degree deformity, and this is significant even for a 4-year-old child. And you can imagine when the cast comes off, there's a very grotesque cosmetic deformity. So this child, this was the clinical picture. So we had to do an open osteoclasis and K-wiring and got the bone restored and then put him back in a cast. So this is really unacceptable for a child who has 40 degree deformity, because parents would not accept this, especially when you've done a previous MUA. So they upset that the forearm is deformed. And this is the child who then came back after cast removal and the bones are well healed. There's also very high incidence of refracture when you leave these bones alone in malunion. So this is an 11-year-old child who came with this malunion. This was a 10-month-old injury. You can see that the forearm is in supination here, the malrotated here, and you can see from the X-ray. So this child was unable to pronate and supinate completely. This is the clinical picture, and you can see that it's complete pronation here. He's unable to supinate. And we had to do a corrective osteotomy for this child. So he underwent the corrective osteotomy to restore the alignment. Now all this can be avoided if one can recognize the malrotation earlier on. So this child, you know, they will come back later on with significant deformities, and then when you go back and look at the X-rays, you realize that all this could have been corrected much easily at the time of the primary injury. So this is what I follow, what is called a 3-week rule. After 3 weeks, usually whatever deformity you get is fixed. So I would always do X-rays after every 1 week and make sure that the alignment is well maintained, both in rotation as well as displacement and angulation. Beyond 3 weeks, it is very difficult to manipulate fractures. So that's why, and this has been very well documented, follow the 3-week rule, you never go wrong. Operative treatment, is for these conditions when the fracture is unstable, unacceptable reductions, open fractures, you will do an open reduction, and there are various ways. Elastic nails, flexible nails, you can use wires, you can use plates. So my preference for a child less than 12 years is to use these titanium nails, which will give good fixation. The nails are the same diameter, maintain the interosseous space, and one must know the technique of putting the wire, putting these nails in. They must be always of the same diameter. Also, we have published about single bone fixation. So you can fix the ulna and leave the radius alone as long as you have less than 15 degree angulation. So single bone fixation, we had published way back in 2001, where you just fix the ulna bone and you restore the length of the ulna bone and the radius will correct itself. Refracture is a big problem in children. Which is a refracture is the second fracture which occurs within 18 months of the first injury. Very common when you leave residual angulation more than 20 degrees, and very common in the mid shaft. So this is an example, couple of examples here. This is a child who had a refracture after 6 months of healing, and he was treated in a cast as it was not badly displaced. This is another child at 14 years old, had this kind of fracture, put in a cast, he healed. So cast was removed at about 6 weeks, and then he started playing cricket, and he came back again with this deformity. So he refractured within 3 months. And you can see there's a mild deformation of the ulna. But he was 14 years old and he almost had this 20 degree deformity. So we did a dorsal plating, ulnar plating, and we got him back to length. He's got a mild ulna bow as well, but refractures at the same point, if you try and re-manipulate, sometimes they don't heal very well. Especially when there's residual deformity of the ulna. So we plated this child, and here is 8 weeks post-op. Distal fractures, again, very, very common to refracture. So this child had a distal radius pinning done, this pin was removed a bit early, and then he presented with this deformity. So lower end radial fractures where there is not much muscle mass, you must protect them or keep the wires for at least 8 to 10 weeks. And before you remove the wires, you must document the fractures healed. So wire removal, you only do, if you want to do it early, you must again put a cast for a few weeks so that you can protect the child in a cast. So that's what I do. I always let the bone heal completely and then remove the wires. If you remove it too early, chances are they will get a refracture. This is again a not uncommon situation where the child falls back with the nails in situ, and you can see the nails are bent. Again, this is a significant injury where the nail is bent and the bone has refractured at the site of the original fracture. And when you try and re-manipulate these, it is not easy because this nail has become now plastically deformed. So like I mentioned earlier, plastic deformation is not easy to treat. So when you have a plastic deformation of the nail, you cannot manipulate this in situ. You can if it's a wire, it's a K-wire, but if a titanium nail, it is not easy to re-manipulate. And we had to remove these nails and you had to put plates. This is another child. This was the initial X-ray. He fell down again and you can see what happened. He got a fracture, refracture, and we used the titanium plates. So these nails have to be removed because we could not bend them. Lower end fractures of the radius, again, very, very challenging because especially when they involve both the radius and the ulna. And you can see what happens when you get this kind of alignment, behavioral apposition in a younger child. You can accept this because this will remodel, and parents should be counseled properly that there is no reduction malalignment, and you will see over the time they will completely remodel within 1 year. So really, if you have behavioral apposition, no reduction malalignment, no angulation in a child less than 10 years, you can completely leave it alone. But they must be counseled that they have to be protected for at least 3 months so that the child doesn't start playing early. Loss of position is very, very common in lower end fractures, especially when they got more than 50% translation. So sometimes you have to stabilize these fractures. So more than 50 degree translation, very high chance they will go into radial angulation because of the pull of the brachioradialis tendon. So these fractures must be stabilized either using K-wires, or you must put a very well-molded cast and take X-rays every week so that they don't displace. And this is what we call the cast index. So the cast index is a ratio of the sagittal diameter upon the coronal diameter, and it should be 0.8. Less than 0.8 means there's a good mold, and you can see the the fracture well maintained. If you cannot maintain them, you must put a wire, and there are various wiring techniques. You can use a wire going from the standard, you can do intrafocal wiring. But if you are going to put a wire, you have to make sure that you get a good reduction. So this is the child who had this kind of reduction. You can leave it alone also. But this child, the surgeon preferred to wire it, and he put these cross wires, and this is how the fracture healed. I would have probably left it alone because you can see the cast index is good, but the surgeon preferred to wire them. Again, you can use various techniques. Intrafocal pinning is well described, because sometimes you can't get in the lower fracture, you can't get a pin from the metaphysis. So you can put an intrafocal wire and you can do a wire reduction and then pass the final wire. So this can be again be used for these kind of displaced fractures. If you want to get a good X-rays, you can do an intrafocal Kapanji reduction and then put these intrafocal wires. Coming to the last point, I don't want to focus only on the proximal joint, but remember one thing, the distal radioulnar joint is equally important, and many times I've seen complications in this joint as well when children come late, and if you don't reduce restore the distal radioulnar alignment, and especially when one bone is involved, and you can see what happens to this child. He had this deformity of the radius, he had this bent ulna, and you can see the angulation of in the cast. So don't only look at the radius. I always tell the residents, look at the ulna alignment as well, and we will miss this. And this child then came back with this gross deformity. It was left alone, and the ulna then bent, and he had the deformity. He had pain at the derugia joint and limitation of pronation. So always align the derugia joint as well. Make sure you have reduced the distal joint, either by close techniques or by doing pinning. So this child again had a lower end radius fracture. It was the Bayonet apposition, and this was the alignment which was accepted in the cast. Now what happened was this child healed with malalignment of the distal radius, but also this led to subluxation of the ulna. And you can see the final picture here. The radius didn't remodel completely, and he had a problem with the derugia. And whenever he used to pronate and supinate, you notice the swelling of the ulna, and this child had a painful subluxation. You can see that the ulna is kind of overgrown, and especially when he used to play the guitar, he could find this bone popping and causing pain. So don't ignore this joint. It is very, very easy to overestimate when treating the radius. We tend to ignore this joint. So lastly, I would mention that whenever you treat forearm fractures, you follow what is called the RAW approach. Look for rotation, look for angulation, and weekly follow-up. If you follow this dictum, you'll always have a good result. Look for rotation X-ray wise, look for angulation, measure the angulation, document it in your notes, so that at follow-up, you're able to counsel the parents that this bone is going to remodel or not going to remodel. And if you feel that it may not remodel, you must counsel them before that this child may need further surgeries after 1 or 2 years. So I will conclude here. If there are any questions, be happy to take, and we have my phone number and our email ID, and I'll be happy to answer any questions. Thank you, Ashok, and thank you, Ortho TV, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. That was an excellent and comprehensive talk on management of forearm fractures. So I'll just ask you a few questions for the benefit of the audience. So which are the most common complications that you have seen in your practice that can be easily avoided in forearm
fractures? I think the most common complication I see is rotation. And commonly it occurs in undisplaced fractures, because whenever we get an undisplaced fracture, the orthopedic surgeon feels this just needs a slab or a cast. And in a busy clinic, you know, they will just apply the slab, or the senior doctor will tell a junior doctor, this is undisplaced fracture, put in a cast. The biggest problem occurs in undisplaced fractures, because when the bone is completely fractured and displaced, we know what to do. Right. We know that we will do an MUA, we will do a fixation, we will do a nailing. It is undisplaced fracture. So the simpler the injury, the more difficult the problem. And I've found that rotational alignments always occur in green stick or plastic deformation. So I would urge the surgeon, whenever they see an undisplaced fracture, give as much attention as they would give to a displaced fracture. Don't ignore So displaced fracture, we treat the X-ray. Undisplaced fracture, treat the patient. See the hand, don't see the X-ray. So that's the big difference, because alignment can be seen clinically at the outset very, very easily. And once you miss the first week and you put a cast, it is not easy to interpret. So my advice is that rotational problems are the commonest I see in practice.
Right. You said about measuring angulations. So how do you measure the angulation on the X-rays, with a scale or to exact degree, or eyeballing is good enough?
This is the most underutilized instrument in practice. Absolutely. It cost 20 rupees, but right, it should always be in a pocket. I must tell you, you must keep it in a pocket. You know, I've always seen a goniometer lying on a table, or you can never find it.
Right.
So I would always measure the X-ray, keep a pencil, right, and you mark it. Because unless you mark it and you eyeball it, you will not know what is the deformity at the first X-ray.
Right.
And this is the most, I think, underutilized instrument, the cheapest instrument. I would advise everybody to keep in the pocket and measure it. Please measure. Because what your eye can see, your mind will read again. If your eye will not note it the first time, you cannot counsel the parents. Sorry. So my advice is, do simple things. You don't need to have fancy CT scans, MRI for forearm. Measure and document. This is the buzzword.
So another query is, you already mentioned about that, but convincing the parents on continuing conservative management, even on when the X-ray is looking, where the bones are looking not really aligned.
Correct.
So convincing the parents is a real trick for most pediatric orthopedic surgeons. So I want to know, what is your trick on doing that?
Now, there is somebody, you know, recently we had somebody discussion on the internet group from abroad.
Right.
And he in the US, and he had a child who had a fracture, 8-year-old child with 30 degree deformity. And the father said, no, I don't want a deformity. Okay. So there is something what we call situational practice. You have to practice in the situation you are in. Now, if the parents insist that I want a perfect looking X-ray, then the surgeon has no choice. But by and large, I will have, you know, you show them clinical pictures. Pictures are always more convincing. So if you are sitting in a clinic, you show them your past X-rays which you have treated, or even you can download it from, I think, BO has got a very, very good chart on fracture remodeling. And if you show the parents that this can happen in a child, especially younger child, less than 10 years, then, you know, when they see a picture, they get convinced. And especially if you tell them that the child needs a scar, needs a plate, needs a nail. So you'll need two surgeries, one for fixation and one to remove the implant. 90% of them, they will get convinced when you tell them they will need two surgeries. But again, like you say, it's you know, now the trend is more towards operative treatment. Parents also, internet, it's called situation orthopedics. Somebody in the you know, you have to see the child, the parents' intelligence as well. Sometimes the ones that are super intelligent, they want super treatment. So, like, you know, it is not always easy to convince, but in 95% you can convince if you show them other X-rays or pictures of remodeling, they will get convinced. But you must have faith in your own treatment. If you have no faith, and if you're not measured, you just eyeball it, then it's not easy. So if you have measured it properly, and you have the chart in front of you, you tell them this is what is literature shows, and this is what I have belief in, and my if you follow my advice, this is going to follow. Okay, so I think you have to have some conviction in yourself before you convince the parents. So with charts and with pictures.
Right. I think those are very good practical tips to utilize in clinic. So I thank you again on behalf of Ortho TV to take this excellent talk, and hope to see you soon. Again, with another interesting topic.
It's a pleasure, and I think, just follow simple things in life, and life will be okay. So take weekly X-rays for every forearm fractures. Keep a goniometer and measure. That's my advice. Thank you very much for this opportunity, and have a great day. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you, sir.